This welcome to the last session of this, what has already been an incredibly rich day. They've given me an all-male panel to close the day off. So I'm going to give priority to women question askers at the end of the presentation. So ladies, be prepared. I think we've come at the moment of the day where we're going to look at let me back up a little bit. I was actually here 10 years ago, chairing a fairly similar panel. We had someone from NIH, we had a CEO of a drug company. There were different people than there are now, except for Bernard Picoult. Some of these people really stick with it, which is fabulous. The theme then was fatal imbalance. The theme today is life in the balance. This is a decade later, and the question really is, are we actually making enough progress? I think there is some consensus that there is progress, but is it enough? Is it fast enough? And do we have the conditions in place to actually sustain the progress, speed it up, and make sure that if we meet again in 10 years, we can actually talk about getting more drugs, better tools out to people. We have until about 5:30 for this panel. We have fabulous panelists. We have Roger Glass, who is the director of the Fogarty International Center and associate director for international research by NIH of the US NIH, and I am very happy that that NIH is so well represented here today, not only for their for their efforts in neglected diseases research, but here I should perhaps also say who I am, which explains why I am happy with NIH. My name is Ellen Athoon, and I've spent the last 3.5 years establishing the medicines patent pool for HIV medicines, and the NIH was one of the first patent-holding entities that stepped forward and licensed these patents to the medicines patent pool. So that gives me always a very warm feeling towards NIH. The second panelist is Christopher Viehbacher, who is the CEO of Sanofi. He has not licensed his patents to the medicines patent pool, but that's only because he doesn't have any HIV patents, otherwise I'm sure he would have. And but he will have a chance to talk about what he is doing in neglected diseases and collaboration with the DNDi. Chichinga Nirungu, is the African Coordinator of Health Action International. He is based in Kenya, Nairobi, and he has been very active. He and his organization, his international network, have been very active in advocating for sustainable mechanisms towards essential health research and development. We're also very happy that Samir Brahmachari, who is the Director General of the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research of India, is here, clearly an important institution, but also a very key country in this field. And then Bernard Picoult, who almost does not need an introduction. He is the Executive Director of the Drugs for Neglected Diseases Initiative, and he was also the founder of the MSF Access to Medicines campaign, and he's been my boss for 10 years, so everything I do wrong today, I learned from him, okay? So, without further ado, I'm going to ask the panelists, all will have the opportunity to give a short introductory presentation. I will hope they will do that in response of a question I will pose to them, but with personalities like this, you never know what they'll do, of course. Dr. Glass, the first question is for you. Throughout the day, we have heard about the considerable contribution of NIH to global health research, including drug development research in the area of neglected diseases. Why is NIH doing this? Why is the US government investing into diseases that may not perhaps be priority problems in the United States, and what needs to be done to ensure that the U.S. government will continue to be involved in this?
Well, Ellen, thanks a lot for the question. And to get started, we started the session this morning with Dr. Fauci, who's really led efforts, and you heard what amazing things are being done. NIH is the largest research institution in the world for funding research, and Dr. Collins has made global health one of the signature programs of his five pillars for his administration as director. So global health now is on the agenda of all the institutes and centers at NIH. I'm director of the Fogarty Center as well, and we see investments in global health as moving the frontiers of science abroad, of training people in the long term to be able to do research on their own in country without the colonial sort of what was called parachute research of the past, but really building up local capacity. And that effort has really paid off in tremendous ways over the last several decades. So that if you look at the advances that have been made in AIDS research in Africa, many of those primary researchers who have made the greatest contributions have been people who have been trained through Fogarty programs, collaborating through long-term training, through collaborations between U.S. and foreign institutions, so that that research becomes absolutely critical, and these people are the stars of the research world in their countries. As an example, and I saw that you've been interested in extremely drug-resistant TB, and the discoveries of XDR-TB and Tegela-Ferry were made by Fogarty fellows who were in the field area finding patients who didn't respond. They went back to their mentor in South Africa, in Durban, and at Yale to figure that out. And these were fellows, young trainees, at the frontier of an epidemic. So they've extended the frontier of science all the way to people who are locally trained but are part of a global network. We see that as being very important. Beyond that, we see this as an absolute priority because as, for instance, HIV and transmission of HIV in children, in infants and newborns has come down, we need to do trials internationally to develop new drugs, new processes, and these are incredibly helpful to us at home. We don't see a huge dichotomy in some ways between global health and local health. Sometimes it's referred to as glocal, because the research that we've done in Peru on cysticercosis really comes home to seeing cysticercosis as one of the prime causes of seizures in children in Houston, in Hispanic populations. And so if we're gonna learn about this, we can learn about it best in the field, and it will be Peruvian investigators who are grantees who work on this. So we really see the research endeavor as being global. We see the investments as being long-term. We see global health not only being the infectious diseases, but the chronic diseases, because that's where we work. And we see implementation science as a critical value, not only to make and develop the drugs and the vaccines and the devices, but to understand people's behavior so that they can actually implement these activities and these new medicines in the field, understanding their behaviors, why they accept new treatments and why they don't. My own area has been rotavirus vaccines. It's clearly been a major problem in the U.S. It's been a major problem for child survival in developing countries. And it's been through developing local researchers, having them do clinical trials around the world, that we really have a global effort with financing from the global community, from the U.S., from WHO, from the Gates Foundation, and from local governments. So that we're working on cheaper vaccines, better vaccines, that will, in the decade of vaccines, or by the end of the decade of vaccines, prevent rotavirus in all children. So let me stop there and leave it open for questions. But we think that global health for us is absolutely vital to extend the frontiers of science, to develop a cadre of wonderful investigators in developing countries who can help us with these missions. And we see these as long-term programs for research and development. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Viehbacher, why is a company like Sanofi involved in neglected diseases research when this is not your primary concern? Your area is more in cancer, in more the chronic diseases, and your primary markets of course more in the north than in the south. And I'm particularly interested in your response in light of the fact that Daniel Vasella in 2006, then CEO of Novartis, said, and he said this in the Financial Times, we have no model which would meet the need for new drugs in a sustainable way. You can't expect for-profit organizations to do this on a large scale. If you want to establish a system where companies systematically invest in this kind of area, you need a different system. So my question to you is, do you feel that we have this different system? Or is this just a temporary involvement from the pharmaceutical companies? You can talk on behalf of your own company. I know you're also the co-chair together with Mr. Bill Gates of the Pharma Roundtable, so to shed a bit of light of what happens there would also be useful.
Maybe just before talking about the neglected disease, I think having listened to the panels this afternoon, it's worth pointing out that as people look for more funding for research, that we shouldn't just suppose that because we have more money that we're going to have more results. I've actually been on a number of panels with Francis Collins, for example, where we've explored the need and the possible solutions to innovate innovations, because if you look at how much money is going into research and development and how little of the extremely promising science is being translated into benefits for patients, we actually have a general problem. And it's not just a money problem, but it is a question of how do you create more collaborative research, how do you create more multidisciplinary research, how do you create different funding mechanisms, how are you going to improve regulatory science to keep up with the science that is leading to new medicines. So there are a lot of challenges. It doesn't matter whether you're in the United States or you're in Europe or you're in Africa. How we get more out of what we're spending on innovation is a general topic. As far as neglected diseases go, I think the issue becomes a little bit more complicated than whether this is simply a matter for corporate social responsibility or there's something else. And I think you have to divide things, you have to divide diseases into a couple of different categories. You can look at it as a disease where there's clearly never going to be a market at any price. And sleeping sickness would certainly fit into that category. Sleeping sickness occurs in the poorest of countries and there's really no economic model other than if a company decides to do a donation program. Then you're going to find diseases where there is a market at least in some part of the world and not in another. And here, HIV was certainly a case of that, but pretty much anything could fall into that. And I think some of the models that have occurred are things like tiered pricing, differentiated pricing within a country. You have people like the Gates Foundation, Global Fund, Gavi, Clinton Foundation, UNITED, which often will step in and at least acquire products even at a minimum on a no-profit, no-loss basis, which allows a certain level of sustainability beyond a donation. And then you can also have markets within a country where maybe there isn't a market for the vast majority of people, but where there's people who can afford at least some level of pricing. So you might take malaria as an example. That there's going to be a population that can't afford a malaria treatment at any price. There's some that could afford it if you gave it to them at this no cost, no profit basis, and there are going to be some who could pay a modest margin on it that helps to subsidize the cost for everybody else. So a little bit of how this works depends on what kind of disease that you're looking at. The other way of looking at this issue, there's this kind of a now issue, there's a tomorrow issue, and there's a future issue. And in some cases, the now is, well, we already have a certain number of medicines. Are we really doing enough with what we already have. And we know that that is clearly not the case. And this is one of the reasons that Bill got the roundtable together to create a fight against neglected diseases. You know, I had the privilege of attending the London Declaration on the 30th of June, January, earlier this year, and saw a dozen companies not only sign up to say we're going to provide medicines on one of these different economic models, but actually we will establish a set of metrics to see, well, how can we actually not only treat, but potentially in some cases eliminate these diseases. And there is actually a whole series of task forces behind that. You know, and as co-chair, I keep an eye on all these different task forces. There's a whole task force on developing metrics for performance, for example. In our company's case, we've taken the commitment to eliminate sleeping sickness by 2020. And so far, if you looked at where things were 10 years ago, 350,000 cases per year, that's down to less than 7,000. And so, you know, there is a credible path to elimination. There is a whole group of people looking at tiered pricing within a country, because this could actually open up different economic models. You know, you've heard that even the Gates Foundation doesn't have unlimited resources. Governments don't have unlimited resources. If you can tap into those people who are suffering from conditions who can afford to pay more, that can help to offset the cost for those who can't afford. And so this differentiated pricing within a market is being piloted in a number of countries around the world. A number of different companies have signed up to sponsor those, and we're all participating in these pilot projects. Then there is a tomorrow issue, which is around, okay, well, we have these medicines today, but one of the reasons that they're not actually being used adequately is that these aren't really that easy to use. And, you know, we heard the question earlier today about deliverable aspects of the products. I was at the Gavi meeting in Tanzania last week, and there was a whole session just dedicated to supply chain. And so companies have committed to developing, for example, tests to show, well, how long can you take your vaccine out of the cold chain before you have a problem with efficacy, because we traditionally developed our vaccine supposing that there's unlimited supply of refrigerators and cold chain. And having personally visited Chad in April this year and watched the treatment of a sleeping sickness, a lumbar puncture at 50 degrees Celsius under a mango tree, it became pretty obvious to me that we needed to do something about a cold chain issue in some parts of the world. So, but that requires stability testing, that requires some investment, that requires a regulatory approach to agree how we can do this. It may require approaches to actually have diagnostics to be able to better track whether the vaccine stays at the right temperature or not. In some cases, where these things are being transported in ice chests, you actually are not so much worried about whether it goes above 8 degrees, but does it go below 2 degrees? Can you freeze the vaccine, for example, and what happens with that? So there's the tomorrow issue, which is around how do we actually innovate in the supply chain? And then the final thing is clearly the future, and that is where, you know, we still need better treatments. And there are a number of different collaborative models that are emerging, and we've had one for quite some time with DNDi. We have had one certainly on the ASAQ combination in malaria treatments. We've moved beyond that to now doing something unprecedented, which is also monitoring safety. If I look at this treatment for sleeping sickness, well, I mean, the first innovation was reducing this package of medicines, these different medicines needed by infusion from 60 kilos to 20 kilos, but it's still way too complicated. And so we actually are developing with DNDi, co-developing a new oral compound, which hopefully could actually eliminate a lot of the heavy logistics around sleeping sickness. But there's a development partnership where DNDi is taking on the clinical development, and we're taking on the industrial aspects of this, and working together to bring this to market. We have a partnership with DNDi, looking at 9 neglected diseases. We have a massive library of compounds. We've developed those obviously for developing medicines in disease areas where we can make some money, But having spent the money on those molecules, it's not a huge cost to us to actually make those available to an organization like the NDI, who may want to screen that library of compounds against targets that they have developed for neglected disease, as an example. And so the reason we actually got the round table together is that if you just look at a neglected disease, there's no business case, and people in big companies at some point in time can't make a decision if there's no business case. However, at a CEO level, you can kind of move beyond those things and sort of say, well, actually, we can do this. This isn't either you want to do this because you're satisfying a corporate social responsibility objective. You may be doing that because you actually see a market ultimately in emerging markets. Sanofi sells more in emerging markets than it does in Europe or the US. Or it may be that actually this doesn't cost that much. We just need to facilitate something and just on a pragmatic basis be helpful. And you need that at a CEO level. And that's why, you know, Bill has got us all around the table and we've been able to move a few things forward. So I think if you set some clear targets on what kinds of diseases you're looking at, what are some paths forward, then I think the industry is gradually moving into that direction.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Chichinga, you have been involved in advocacy for research and development for neglected diseases, also for access to medicines, and your organization has been involved together with many others here in the audience in advocacy for a medical research and development treaty, something that was on the agenda of the WHO not so long ago. It has come up earlier today. However, we've seen that real action is being postponed until at least 2016, which doesn't seem to quite be in sync with the sense of urgency that was also conveyed at the same time. Now, what do you think this says about the appetite of governments to take their responsibilities, and what do you think should happen next?
Thank you for the question, and I think it's an important question to reflect upon, but maybe before I get into the two parts of that question, I think first of all, we need just to focus on a reality check and just to be quite conscious, as has been said in the preceding presentation since this morning, that we're actually facing a crisis in terms of R&D for neglected diseases, but also, as we know, also in terms of some of the other public health challenges that are emerging, particularly in the South, for example, the increasing cases of cancer, the whole crisis of non-communicable diseases. I think these obviously are presenting a new dimension to the complexity of this challenge of R&D. So it's not just an issue about neglected diseases. And I think what this says is that there is certainly then a need to rethink about the paradigm that is that currently informs how R&D is perceived and the options and the priorities that have been established, and especially to focus on how best can we address the needs of the poor populations, vulnerable populations, within a context where actually the challenge seems to be growing by the day as new public health challenges either manifest or become more severe. And I think the other issue, of course, is to emphasize that when we think about R&D, we cannot just think about it in isolation, but we must see it as a subset of other issues that impact on why the challenge is this manifest. For example, the whole question about the intellectual property system, and therefore the discussion that have preceded about, for example, the need to ensure that there's delinkage so that the whole question about price is not tied to the cost of developing new products into the market, and therefore impacting on access, as has already been said. That said, I think you have rightfully pointed out that we have kind of found ourselves in a very difficult situation, because the discussions that happened just fairly recently under 2 weeks in Geneva were not able to make progress as was expected, or at least as many of us had hoped would happen. regarding some agreement on an R&D treaty. And I think it's important to emphasize that the scale of the challenge that we face actually calls for a multilateral approach to the problem. I do not think that countries can be able to resolve the issues about R&D just in terms of standalone initiatives that focus on the resources, for example, that countries can be able to put on the table, or the initiatives they can be able to develop on their own, or even if within some other arrangement that is outside a multilateral framework. I think the scale of the problem calls for a compact solution, which brings on board as many countries as possible so that the burden can be shared more equitably, and therefore the results can be focused a lot more effectively. So on the issue of the R&D, I think, the failure of the discussion on the R&D treaty, I think what is important to focus on is that it should not become a source of paralysis and inaction. If anything, I think governments must be much more motivated, civil societies must be much more motivated to continue insisting on a framework that can deliver and fix the current problem. And certainly, what happened in Geneva must actually be seen as a step back, not as a fallback position. So what this says, of course, is that I do not think it says that governments are not interested or are not committed. I do not want to see it that way. But I think it emphasizes that generally, governments are cautious about taking action. It almost emphasizes a reluctance on the part of government to commit, what they say or what they have always said that they need to fix this problem with actually tangible commitments on the table. So certainly that's what it says. But I think it also says that within that kind of thinking, and given that, for example, that currently R&D just constitutes about 2% of the GDP, and for example, when you look at countries, for example, most countries in the South and certainly in Africa, many of them are even way below even 1% in terms of GDP, in terms of their investment in R&D as a measure of their GDP. So that already says that actually the problem is likely to become much more manifest. So I think we have a crisis in that sense, and we need to move forward. So I think what we need to emphasize is that we must put the pressure, and governments must really be made aware, which I believe they are, but probably many of them might not necessarily be really very much alive to this challenge, that the current model of R&D has failed, that it is not possible to rely either on just mobilization of national resources within budgets, because as I've said, these are generally insignificant, or even where resources are actually placed in the budget for R&D, they are insufficient to meet the scale of the challenge. Also to reemphasize that the challenge itself requires a multilateral approach, and also that even sources of funding, for example, reliance on resources, for example, from donor partners or development partners, again, is not sufficient to meet the scale of the challenge. So I think within that complexity, we must continue to put pressure on governments to put their minds on the need for an R&D treaty.
Thank you very much. I'm sure we'll come back to that in the discussion. I would like to now invite Professor Samir Brahmachari, and I understood you had a few slides you wanted to use with your presentation.
Thank you, Bernard and Bhavna, to get me here. My biological clock is 3 o'clock in the morning, and if I sit down and talk, I might sleep off. So I thought I'd stand up and talk. Today, we found out that there are three types of people who are concerned with the neglected disease. One, those who talk and suggest policy. Number two, those who are funding neglected disease in the capacity of philanthropy with the Bill Gates Foundation and the government. And category three, those who directly do R&D
discover, innovate, and implement. Unfortunately or fortunately, I have all the three responsibility simultaneously. And one advantage I have that I don't have to convince anybody to get fund, because as a Secretary of Government of India, I give fund to the Director General of CSIR, which is the largest organization in India, and then it allocates budget, DGCSIR, to the OSDD unit, Open Source Drug Discovery Unit. I just want to say that the solution lies, because your session is mechanism of facilitating functioning, financing, and coordinating. So we can overcome this obstacle if we go for open innovation. It was so nice that my Brazilian friend, he exactly said that. So I believe when it comes to health, we need to have a balanced view between health as a right and health as a business. With this philosophy, Open Source Drug Discovery was initiated. It's a CSIR Team India consortium with global partnership with a vision to provide affordable healthcare. The concept is to collaboratively aggregate the available biological genetic information, which in the morning Antony mentioned, and integrate them in a system level, and eventually identify complete disruptive way of drug discovery. And the open source model is successful already in the human genome sequencing, Linux, and therefore it should work. And OSDD provides a global platform where the best mind can come and work and collectively contribute to solve the complex problem. And we started on 15 September 2008, 4 years down the road. We have over 6,600 registered participants from 130 countries. And the best part is you don't have need visa to work, and you don't have to travel to another country to work. You can go to the OSDD portal, and then you will see that. Unfortunately, what we have not discussed, that our drug discovery today remains the way aircraft was discovered by Wright brothers. And in 40s, hundreds and hundreds of prototypes were built before 747 was actually flown. But 777 hasn't been done that way. It has been completely CAD designed, computer simulated, only one prototype built, first manufactured, and all flying was done in computer. And today, the same way Formula One cars are developed, only two are eventually manufactured, and one runs the race. So drug discovery needs a disruptive change from the old model to the new model. And I'm sure I flew in 777. It was a wonderful flight. All we have done, we have created a semantic web-based portal, extremely complicated, but taking advantage that it took, I think, 38 years to get 50 million people in radio, and it took only 1 year to get 50 million people on Facebook. And I think 9 months, 50 million people got into the Twitter. So taking advantage of this portal is a semantic web 3.0, in which Twitter, Facebook, everything is built in. And all projects of open source drug discovery are managed here. You can go register yourself, and you can see this, and that's the difference. So it's completely open, but it is, and everybody knows. So what I say that we have a problem, we have fallen behind, and we need disruptive innovation, not simple. Money is important. But I can tell you money is not the solution. I allocated $120 million for this project. When I became Director General, first I allocated $12 million. And I can tell you, just giving you one example, we have molecules now moving into clinical trial. We have lots of drugs, leads come. We haven't even spent $12 million in 4 years. And they're because very large number of people do things, don't charge, including lawyers. And so therefore, open source drug discovery is no longer a professional activity. It has become an emotional enterprise. So therefore, if we can see neglected disease, we need disruptive innovation. And that's all.
Well, what better introduction to the next speaker, because disruptive is the many years that I've known Bernard is what he's all about. So, and I say that with a great deal of love and admiration, Bernard, as you know, 10 years of efforts to scale up research, development of products for neglected diseases. As I said, we've gone from fatal imbalance, and now the lives are hanging in the balance. How much progress is there? Have we really made? The consultative expert working group recommended negotiations on new rules. In fact, they recommended to disrupt a little bit the way we've been doing things. New rules and different approaches towards the financing of it. Yes, perhaps we do need less than what we think we might need, but without actually looking at what kind of mechanism you would have to put in place, we might not get there. So, Bernard, what new norms in medical R&D do we need? What incentives do you believe are needed? Are they all carrots, or do we also need sticks?
Thank you, Ellen. But of course, I want to say I'm very happy to be back here 10 years later. And I will not refer to the meeting that we set up 10 years later. I will refer to the event that MSF set up in front of the meeting, because MSF at that time had a very large American truck just in front of the meeting in the Fifth Avenue. And this truck was transformed in a consultation center. And the visitors were getting a ticket through a lottery, and on the ticket the name of the disease, and they enter into the truck, and they were explaining what sort of symptoms they will be confronted with, the disease, and at the end they were offered the treatment. And those who received a ticket on sleeping sickness were informed at the end of the visit that they will receive Arsebal, and that they will be exposed to the risk of 5% death because of the toxicity of the drug. So I think the change that occurred during the last 10 years is now all patients with a stage 2 of sleeping sickness, almost all of them, are receiving a better treatment. So the Arsebol is no more used. So I think it's, for me, it's a victory. And we have to learn from this. Of course, the second point is that was described already this morning, is that and particularly if I talk collectively on a PDP group, of course there is some attractive candidate in the pipeline, so it's a second chance. But my communication now is more to talk about the challenges that we have in front of us, and I would like to bring four challenges. Because we still need to boost innovation. There is still major gaps in several portfolios because we have not yet candidates that are acceptable. So here, we need to have more access to the knowledge. We need to have more access to the compounds and libraries. We need to be innovative and move into more open source models. I totally support Dr. Brahmacharai. In order to avoid duplication because of the context of our diseases, to create synergy between the different groups, including between private companies, because we have a responsibility to save cost and speed up the process. On this, having in mind that access is the issue at the end, so any agreement that we sign, even at a very early stage, should have access in mind. So you need to guarantee access to the patients. Second challenge is to develop what I will call innovative partnership for the drug development. And in the morning, many people have mentioned this delinkage model. So I think we are implementing this delinkage model. Chris Verbacher referred to the AZAC is typically a delinkage model because we did with many partners the clinical development and we agree from the beginning that the drug will be available at cost. So I think it is possible to have this. But I think in this innovative partnership, you need also to consider another important element that is a major barrier today is to be innovative in terms of regulatory process. Regulatory is a major barrier to success in a drug development. And when we are confronted to major diseases with a very high risk-benefit analysis, we need to be innovative on this. MDR-TB, of course, is a good example of that. My third aspect is that we need to involve partners in endemic country in the field directly from A to Z. So they need to be involved at the beginning when you set up your priority, when you set up the TPP that has been mentioned before, until the end, because of course, as soon as you have a success, the challenge is implementation. According to me, it's a key challenge is to involve more in all the process endemic countries. The challenge number four, of course, is sustainable money, sustainable funding, because of the nature of R&D, it's not possible to have no visibility on your investment. So you need to have some guarantee that when you engage into the research and development, and particularly when you are at the development stage, because here you have an ethical responsibility, you need to go to the end. So here there is a need for new mechanisms. So United is an example. I think many countries are talking about this financial transition tax, so part of this tax could go to R&D. But of course, there is other mechanisms that have been mentioned previously, and price could be one that could also present some interest. But at the end of the day, and I think here I will repeat a message that many people have already addressed today, because at the end of the day, the resources will be limited. We need more resources, but we will always be limited in terms of resources. So it's why we need a coordination of efforts, and we need a framework to regulate this process. Being when all the challenges I've addressed will not be put in place without some principles and without a framework that will stimulate and maybe sometime being a little bit more than stimulate is maybe where you want to bring me. So it's also you have to oblige some of the partners to do what they need to do when they need to address some major public health needs. So it's the only way, according to me, to make progress in the next 10 years.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Bernard. I want to go back to the theme that we've heard a little bit throughout, and also what you just mentioned. You have to build in from the beginning the access. It isn't just about innovation, it is about access. I remember very well when 10 years ago with the MSF Access campaign, the theme was very much access to existing drugs. When we started to do more and more work on the R&D gaps, we discovered that those were actually two sides of the same coin. For example, NIH, how do you today, in your efforts to increase research towards development of new TB drugs, how do you, from day one, build in the notion that those products will have to be available and affordable to the communities and the individuals at the end of the day need access to them? And those communities and individuals will, of course, predominantly be outside the United States.
Alan, it's a great question, and I'm not sure that the issues of access, NIH does not make drugs, and so the issue of how these are commercialized and the price at which they're sold is beyond us. We have a huge patent pool, and that's made available, as you said at the beginning, to licensees and manufacturers, and there's an ample pipeline of novel research and investigation and patents which are available and are accessed. So I think that way novel inventions can be used, and develop. I think the process development by manufacturing is a whole other science in which we're not directly involved.
In terms of the theme of delinkage, and here for Bernard and Chris Fiebacher, which is the notion of separating, in a way, the market of innovation from the production and the production market and the marketing of the product. Bernard, you have experimented successfully with that within the D&DI. Mr. Fiebacher, how do you see that play a role for other diseases?
Well, let me get a start. First, you know, I think one of the things that's important is to really understand how research and development is done. So, you know, you don't really start one morning and say, well, we've got this disease, let's get a team together, get a budget together, and now let's go find a cure for this disease. It doesn't quite work that way. You know, somewhere along the line, you have to develop an understanding of what's the cause of a disease. And this understanding of a cause is really a long journey. And you may find, actually, mechanisms of action, you may find things in science that you don't really associate immediately with a disease. And in fact, translating the science into the disease is a relatively more recent phenomenon in science. But there's an understanding you may start with something like inflammation, or you might start off with something in infectious disease, or you might start off with something in genetics, and then that will lead you to an understanding, this actually could be useful in this disease. So, and at that point, and this is really a lot of the work that is done with the NIH, and so the NIH is developing a lot of the basic science that is so important for others to build upon and that we then take forward, for instance, as an industry. As an industry, we're not really doing a lot of those basic science experiments because the risk of it and the breadth of this is so vast. And, you know, there's the NIH in the U.S., you've got INSERM in France, you've got other organizations, you've got universities, you've got it going on in China and India now. So there is a cumulative knowledge that is coming down. And at some point, you're going to say, well, here's a cause of disease, here's a target. Now we need to go develop a molecule for that. Well, there again, you're going to come up with, well, these things may differ in terms of what economic model. If I take the dengue vaccine, for example, our company acquired a company called Acambus, and the cumulative experience of Acambus plus Sanofi Pasteur is 20 years to bring a dengue vaccine together, you know. There are four different viral subtypes, and the vaccine's got to hit all four of those. But you know, we're seeing dengue now in the Florida Keys. There will be a market for someone to pay a relatively high price for a dengue vaccine, much like any other vaccine. There are going to be countries, you know, in sub-Saharan Africa, for example, where there is no money, and so you're going to develop a pricing model where you're essentially trying to get cross-subsidization. But, you know, ultimately we can see with the dengue vaccine that in a certain number of markets, we'll be able to recover our investment in that. And there are going to be some markets where you're not. And if you take the total number of doses that you need for dengue and the total cost, you can still make a business model work. So, as I say, a lot of these really depend on what disease it is you're talking about. We also don't necessarily really start with neglected diseases versus any other disease. You know, the science evolves and finds causes for disease. Afterwards, there is a market or there isn't a market. That's the real only difference between a neglected disease and any other disease. Every disease is important. Just there are some people, there are some diseases that are afflicting people who have no money. And it's those that are the most difficult. And that is going to be a mix of philanthropy, but it's also finding some of the disruptive research models that can make this cheaper. Regulatory affairs is extremely important because this adds to the cost of developing a drug, which means that, especially if there's no market afterwards, whether it's a Gates Foundation or whether it's a Gavi or whether it's a pharmaceutical company, means that the bar is that much higher for developing it. So, you know, it's kind of hard to come up with generic one-size-fits-all models for these things. A lot depends on what disease it is we're talking about, what science already exists. Remember, and this is, again, this point about money. Money is not always the answer. If money were the only thing that mattered, we'd have a cure for Alzheimer's disease. There's a huge market for Alzheimer's disease, but we'd have no cure. And it's only because the science isn't there. And that's why some of these disruptive innovation models are absolutely critical, because despite an awful lot of money going in there, we're still not unleashing the creativity needed to find a cure.
Thank you. And
actually, your question of affordability, availability, and accessibility is a very good example is HIV drug. And you can see that the drug was discovered. Original drug had a $10,000 treatment price. Then an innovative steps of synthesis was developed under one of our laboratory at CSIRCT. And a tie-up with the Cipla brought the price down to $80. And therefore, it not only became affordable, it also production was, you know, Cipla is $1 billion turnover, and it's also made available, and it was available and accessible at Africa. So all the way, and this allowed also within the WIPO framework. So this is an example. So can we repeat this? Today, cancer drug, it is not affordable, it is available, but it's not accessible. The affordability decides accessibility, but affordability does not mean accessibility is guaranteed. So therefore, there is the issue. If we can make discovery cheaper, then we do non-exclusive licensing, then everything becomes, you know, I think the Francis Collins initiative and our initiative are two examples of government funding, where the entire budget is coming from government. Very few people realize that it is 1951 India established the first Central Drug Research Institute, CSIR, with which DNDi work, you know, everybody works. That's the malarial main center. New discoveries have come from there. So government has an obligation. Therefore, you cannot say the government can escape. I'm concerned that if we reduce government's responsibility in healthcare, we are actually doing a wrong thing. You know, government spends billions of dollars to do discovery. I'm very surprised that why it should be handed over to a few companies eventually to make product. So it is the model that we discussed in the morning, which hasn't got passed in the Committee of Nations, that it should continue. Government should be a partner. Then we have a non-generic. We convert into a non-exclusive licensing where it is essential, where the market force will not work. And where market force will work, we can allow it to market force to work. So this decision, I think, has to be taken very judiciously. And I think the NIH recent initiative and very classical CSIR, you know, we have several laboratories. You know, if you ask me, today we have decided to create a million chemical molecules using 10,000 students and 100 scientists in next 10 years and make it a molecule available library. We started it 3 months back. Today, 1,100 molecules have been synthesized and deposited. And it costs me only $50 per molecule. So therefore, a $50 million, we can create a million molecule library. It's just incredible. You cannot do it by using the MSc students of the university. So we have to come up with some different way to reduce the cost of discovery. And once discovery is done, I am confident that there is enough generic industry from Israel, Teva, Hungary, you know, whatever it is. There are Santa Biotechs, although it is now with Sanofi Aventis, right? But the molecule that is the vaccine, low-cost vaccine, Santa played a very havoc role. Today we are the pride we are talking about, vaccine has done well in the world, is because of the Santas of the world. Sorry. Right? And that's why they have been sold at such a high price to Sanofi.
So you're bringing us back to the core question.
As long as Sanofi manufactures, as long as Sanofi continue to manufacture and give it in $0.50 vaccine for hepatitis B, I think access will stay. But if tomorrow Sanofi decides that use the same capacity and sell it to people who can afford to pay $5, then the access to Africa will go.
No, but that was exactly
so therefore, it's a very, very important, I'm only trying to say, but that discovery of that low-cost manufacturing was developed in CSR CCMB laboratory. It's a public funding, went to Santa, and Santa Biotech became now Sanofi Santa Biotech. Right? So you have to see that how price accessibility is a global marketplace. So it is also obligation of the government and the international bodies to see essential healthcare is a right for all. It's actually a fundamental right. And that should not be done. And I'm very glad that Francis Collins, NIH, is actually caught, you know, very, very seriously taken. And I hope your president this term, without any fear, to come back again, he can take that decision.
very good point. You also echo what the speaker from Brazil said earlier. Things started to change when we recognized in our country that it was a right. You start to do things different. When the rules that govern change, you start to do things differently. And I think that is what we are discussing here today. And perhaps, indeed, not money is not always the answer, but I think what we are, the challenges that we are facing today in neglected diseases research, I think there is a consensus that sustainable financing and predictable financing will continue to be a demand, and I don't have the feeling that we've got our head around yet how we're going to do that. So that is now why I will open it up for comments and questions from all of you. I said I would give priority to women, so Eve, you sit down. I even have people give me little slips of paper, so that's another way to get on the priority list. But I would like to, and particularly on the question of sustainable financing and new rules and norms, and increasingly global, because I don't know whether anyone has counted the number of times that the word global is used, but clearly no one or no country or no entity can do things on their own. It is all about collaboration, it is about sharing, and it is about attacking these things at the global level. Now, how are we going to do that if we haven't got a global system, if we haven't got some kind of financing organized through that? And that I would hope that Ms. Fabienne Bartoli, who is representing the permanent mission of France here at the United Nations, who would like to say a few words, and I hope that she will say a few words about this theme. You can take the microphone there. No, you're not going to get my place. No one is okay.
Yeah, thank you to give me the floor. I appreciate to be here today. And just on this question of the sustainable financing, I just want to mention that in France we just vote finance tax on transactions, and one part of this new financing going to the action on health and specific development health. And in this issue, there was one part of this going to the R&D.
Fabulous. Now I regret I didn't give you my place.
No. And just to add something, but it was about my previous responsibility in France, I noticed that a very, very big and important issue, it's about the registry things, and it's an important cost of a new drug, or even existing drugs in developing countries. And I think we can promote more coordination in this issue between the health authorities, particularly in Europe. So I think it's one piece to go on.
Can I ask you a follow-up question? What is France going to do to encourage other countries to adopt the financial transaction tax and to make sure that a significant amount of money raised through that mechanism goes towards global health?
So the first question is, we had a model because we did that in 2004, you know, with the tax on the flying tickets, you know, for United and all these topics. And we're going to do the same thing to make some convince, to make some lobbying for convince all partners to adopt some the same kind of taxes. But it's not so easy, but it's a model. And for the second part of your question, and to be sure that this new money going to this action, I think that a new issue in Geneva for an observatory, for coordinate this observatory for looking for where this money goes back. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a good way to encourage in this issue. Thank you.
But not enough.
Yeah. Right. It's never enough, but not like Chris Weber has said, it's money, it's not the only answer.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I do it like this. This is not a female bias.
It's
yes, it
me,
is.
Helen.
Nick.
It's Kim.
Nichols. Kim, go ahead.
Hi, I'm Kim Nichols. I'm the NGO rep on the UNITAID board. I just want to comment and then a question. I do feel that anyone who's doing an R&D has a responsibility to have an access policy. I think that was kind of the way Ellen led her question, and I heard from Dr. Brahmachari that his answer was he agrees with that. But I also think at NIH that's also a responsibility as well. My question is for Dr. Brahmachari, and it's really about the open source drug discovery platform. How do you gather the market intelligence that helps you to decide how you proceed with which molecules? How do you gather the intelligence and how do you use that, if you do? And it's sort of a similar, I think also for NIH, the same question prevails if it applies. Thanks.
Thank you. Just one moment. I'm going to collect a few questions and then give the panel a chance to respond, because perhaps also other people would like to respond to some of the questions. So I saw Yves Champé walk up to the microphone. I cannot see
I'm
whether
a woman.
He's there.
Els Torella, Open Society Foundations. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Brahmachari, for a very inspiring presentation. I really like your concept of disruptive innovation. And the example you gave of the open source drug discovery project that you're undertaking. And Bernard also mentioned that DNDi is also embracing open source models. And for me, if I think about open source, there are at least two very important concepts. The first is knowledge sharing. Now, knowledge, not just a little bit of knowledge, like in publications, the summary data, or real knowledge sharing means all knowledge sharing, such that all other scientists can actually have the same information and use their own brains and thinking to advance the research with the same basis of evidence. And the second is crowdsourcing, because that is also what you do. You actually, through knowledge sharing and then all knowledge sharing, you can actually effectively crowdsource, because if you only give bits and pieces of the data or the research tools, etc., the rest of the crowd has not really the capacity to effectively investigate, does not have all the data. And so my question based on that is actually for Bernard and for Mr. Wiebacher. And in the interactions that DNDi as a PDP has increasingly with pharmaceutical companies, and pharmaceutical companies such as Sanofi Aventis, but also the others, with all the PDPs, there is a lot of talk about open source. But I don't think that so far we've seen a commitment for all data sharing. And I think that I really feel that there needs to be movement there, that it can only happen real open source if all data are shared. And I want to know from both Bernard and Mr. Wiebacher whether there is indeed a commitment in moving forward to be much more progressive in that, and then we can actually start doing crowdsourcing and real open source in the way that the open source, the drug discovery project in India is doing now.
Okay, so your question is, where are you with that and why isn't that moving faster? I'll come back to the panel, so take notes in case I forget. Eve. And after Eve's question, which will be very brief, I'll turn to the panel and I'll have a second brief round of last questions. So line up to the microphone.
Thank you.
Male,
thank you,
female,
thank
whatever.
You, I am Yves Champé, and with some of the few people present in this auditorium, I have been very active in two reflecting, conceiving, and building DNDi. And with all these people and the DNDi team, I share the pride of having contributed to changing things. But at the same time, when I'm listening, what I'm listening since this morning, and especially with this panel, I strongly feel that we are at the NDI and in this field of neglected diseases, missing understanding the rules of innovation. Pharmaceutical industry, biotech industry, all the health industry has for the last 10 years while we were building the NDI very well reflected on the need for innovation and what are the different elements which are helping access to innovation. Good quality people, tight and close relationship to academic research, intellectual property, funding, and a few elements. And when you have all this, you are not sure to have access to innovation. So my question to the panel, and more specifically to Mr. Vibhasher and Mr. Brahmachari, is that how an organization like ours, on the subject, on the difficult subject into which we are, can improve access to the different elements which are constituting of innovation. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Eve. So, Mr. Brahmachari, you had the first question from Kim Nichols.
Yeah, if you follow the portal, you'll realize that it has lots of volunteers who are actually take up jobs themselves. So our focus at this moment is tuberculosis, and we have just committed that we'll move into the malaria, and subsequently maybe leishmaniasis and filariasis. So these are the four diseases in which CSIR, my laboratories in India, publishes an enormous number of papers, but so why we thought we have enough number of people, we should be able to do that. So far collecting the market intelligence is concerned, it is in. Already we know what is the situation with respect to tuberculosis, where we stand, what are the problems, what are the challenges. Throughout the day you heard all these questions. So it's very, is this nothing? We all know. The fact that I can just share, Spiegelman's here? Mm. Well, okay. One of the combination for MDR, which actually TB Alliance has now joined and signed MOU with OSDD to do it in an open source model with a data public availability, so at India phase two clinical trials. So this will move on very recently. We are just waiting for government clearance to start the project. So we have already agreed. So therefore you can see the best of the world, the NDI, we are already with the malaria, right? And other things. So we are open to everybody. You will be surprised that the fantastic people, including Tom Blundell of FRS from London, he is working on the project. So there's so many brilliant people has come in, and very little. They may just charge a postdoc amount, that's all. So it is not the money. So therefore our intelligence, actually this crowd is a very interesting crowdsourcing. They themselves comes back and says it's wrong, you're not suggesting wrong. So we could analyze, just to give you an example, 26,000 published literature. Now we had a problem that many literatures are not accessible unless you pay for it. So three of, half a dozen young people
decided to email all the authors of 16,000 papers which were locked up. And authors actually sent a copy of the reprint. And these six students actually built this library, which is accessible to all OSD players. Now, every annotation that has been put in to get the system biology model, we have just built the entire system biology model of MTB. 1,452 reactions involving 900 genes with 1,400 metabolites. It's a fabulous structure built by these kids. And every annotation is actually connected to a publication, and a publication is available in the internal library of the portal. So therefore, anybody can correct and check. So this is the what we call, you said very beautifully, it is all knowledge sharing. It is not selective knowledge sharing. And I think this is the right approach. Then if we can connect the youth, I tell you where our still problem, I believe, that we have to get the best mind. We have lots of brilliant kids participating from Berkeley, but I can't get Harvard Business School boys to come and give me a business model. So I need the best mind of the world.
Try the girls.
And the best young mind of the world to get connected. And this we can do, and I can tell you, if we can emotionally engage them, tomorrow you will see healthcare will not have a business model at all. Healthcare will be absolutely, just like everybody can get rice, apple food, available at a reasonable cost, you don't have to send so much money to buy a cancer drug. You know, in America, the problem is your insurance policy, the money government spends. In India, 80% money is spent, 80% healthcare is spent by the people. Government spends the upfront money, that's why. So my argument is government should spend upfront to make the cost low.
Okay.
Rather than if some people spend their whole life savings to if you get a cancer drug. So this is the, so your public, you know, this private-public partnership, according to me, must come with all knowledge sharing. This partial knowledge sharing, what we call now, early stage open source, I think is done. You know. Finally, you have to make sure, are you creating wealth for few, or you are saving wealth of many?
Okay.
When you save wealth for many, health for all, that's the philosophy we should be clear.
So, Bernard, on that note, where are you on data sharing?
I would like to say that DNDI is trying to develop this model one by one. So we our responsibility is to test new model, to sign agreement, to open, and of course the ambition is clearly to share the knowledge, and we try as much as possible to share the knowledge when we are in a position to do it. And we need to do more, and I mentioned recently what we did with MMV that put the malaria box in a public domain with all the information, so we had access to all this information, and we have worked together to select potential candidates. So I think it's exactly our responsibility to test model and to share this model. But I would like to say, and it's something that we have stated in this document, as PDP, we are not the solution to the problem. So I would like to go back to the public leadership, because I think if we have some good models that we test for this open innovation, as well as for speeding up the development process and the regulatory process, this need to be translated into norms and regulation that will facilitate to change the model. So it's where I'm linking the experience developed by PDP into something that need to be adapted and need to be under control of the public sector to transform innovative model, innovative experience or potential success into something that is sustainable.
Thank you. Thank you, Bernard. I promised a second round of questions and remarks, but we are really running out of time, and I regret that I'm going to have to close the panel very soon, but not without giving the panelists a last opportunity to make a final comment. There was one question to Mr. Fiebacher, which he hasn't had a chance to respond to, but I would like to add one. Perhaps the financial transaction tax and making sure that a significant chunk of that goes toward global health, wouldn't that be something to put on the agenda of your next CEO roundtable to see what you can do as advocates for that? And perhaps, Chichinga, you could work with Mr. Fiebacher on advocacy for that, because if you have a group of CEOs and the CEOs of CEOs, Bill Gates behind you, it should definitely happen. Mr. Glass, I don't dare ask you what you expect the US government will do with that, but with all the open sharing you do and the additional money that would come available through such a mechanism, you might contribute nevertheless. So with these last comments, each of you can say one sentence that you really feel you would like to share with the audience, preferably focusing on something you have learned today you would like to take back and share with your colleagues when you go back to your institutions and your countries. And it is one sentence each. Dr. Glass.
You could have gained two sentences.
I'm just thinking of the last issue that was brought up, of the access to brains and the importance of open access and information and the information communications spread through NLM, through open access, the Public Library of Science, and through the different activities such as the MIMS, which had a ability to transmit and support communications among young investigators and investigators around the world, which is an incredibly powerful tool to expedite discovery in science. And I think just that communications ability through information communication technology, absolutely important. Open access through NLM is something we haven't mentioned, but it, to me, is critically important. Absolutely. Making research available.
Thank you very much. Mr. Fiebacher.
Innovation is done by brilliant people. And I know the human need is immense, but there are no shortcuts. We have thought sometimes it's patents, sometimes it's money, sometimes it's data. If only we could solve one of those problems, we'd have innovation. But the reality is, it's brilliant people who are needed. And the science today is so complicated that you need different brilliant people. There's no one brilliant person who's going to solve the scientific equation. Finding the right models where you can bring these brilliant minds together, where you can bring the elements, a chemical database, a library of compounds is helpful, but in itself is totally useless unless you have a target to screen that against. Who's the bright mind that's going to screen that library of compounds against which target? And sharing data, there's more data out there than we even know what to do with. Finding which data, which models, how are we going to use things like Watson to go and interrogate these databases, correlate physical symptoms of disease with the genetic databases that are being generated every day. Those are the things that are going to matter. So, you know, this is what we're trying to do with DNDI. I think this is the force of DNDI, is trying to bring the right people, bring the right resources into a focus on those things that maybe those people wouldn't otherwise focus on, that they might be thinking about something else. But they really highlight the important need of things like neglected diseases and get those brilliant minds and get the resources behind it. But it is that complex. It is no one single magic bullet.
Thank you. Chichinga. And from here on, the sentences have to get a little shorter.
Yeah. I think what has come out today is that countries need a joint approach, that collaboration is not an option. And I think that collaboration, particularly between research centers and centers of excellence, will obviously be very much in need, and that we also need to find a way in which we can use resources much more effectively, because we've been told it's not just a question about money, it's also about creating efficiencies around the way resources are used. And finally, I think the point that needs restating is that there's still the need for a bold political visioning in terms of a global health diplomacy that will ensure that this collaboration actually helps to advance the objective of innovation in the way R&D is framed.
Thank you.
You know, genome came with a lot of promise. Mycobacterium tuberculosis genome sequence came in 98. It's almost 14 years. We actually haven't used the genomic knowledge. And my belief is that comprehensive analysis with all sorts of getting a non-toxic target, believing in pathways, it's a very complicated exercise. But we must, that's where we make the best bread. And once that is done, actually it's a model setup. Then we know how to make drug discovery, maybe, or very complicated science. But what is my concern after the whole day? You know, I haven't spent a day worrying about meeting with so many people because I don't sit in such meetings. That companies 20 years back made a mistake. The mistake is the shareholders feel like to keep the company stock high, you push third phase three clinical trial. Valuation goes up. Bottom line is important, but shareholders' valuation is important. So as a result, although FDA wants only two clinical trials at the phase three level, in an average, 35 to 40 clinical trials are done for the most of the drug. That's why the price has gone up. Where genome sequencing price has come down from $1 billion to thousands of dollars. You know, I'm an advisory member of the X Prize. I know that, how it will be $1,000 tomorrow. Whereas drug discovery has gone the other way. Number two, so by pushing phase three clinical trial to keep the valuation high, my fear is that MSF, DNDi, again to please the donors, pipeline should not be the objective, because pipeline is very dangerous. Keeping things in the pipeline means I'm hoping things will happen. Whereas government funding wants outcome. Government only wants to know how many people are no longer dying. Polio is not happening. So my request is we need a 2022 resolution. That's what we have taken. That from 1,000 people death per day, we want to bring it down to 100 people death per day. So that's the outcome. We don't care how it happens, whether the new drug, the drug regimen, discipline. So I think DNDi has to say, this we will do. And we have done very well with respect to certain areas. Okay. So my request is, let's not fall in the trap of the pipeline that gives evaluation. What is important is a target base reduction in the suffering, and that could be our focus.
Thank you. Bernard, final word.
I think because of the diversity of the situation, diversity of the disease, diversity of the problem that we have documented, I think we'll not find one solution that will fit for all. So we need a set of tools to try to stimulate a little bit this issue. And the second point is we need to connect innovation to access and have permanently this connection in mind, because what we are talking about today is diseases of poverty. So it's linked to the issue of poverty. It's a rational, I think, to bring clearly the government and the public sector on a leadership role. They need to attract many partners. You need to bring many partners in this solution, but the leadership needs to be clearly on the end of governments and of course, WHO as an international organization.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Great thank you to all the panelists. Please join me in thanking them.